Series of 10 episodes of the revelation of Jesus Christ. Are you seeing? Are you seeing the vision? Is he getting clearer and clearer? Amen?
Yes.
Yeah? Well, what we've been doing here is learning to focus on Jesus Christ. There's so many distractions around that are vying for our attention. And this thing over here and this thing over here, and they're saying, watch me, watch me. And it's only a focused person. It's only a focused church that can be able to follow, well, like we're going to see in chapter 14, the Lamb wherever he goes. You got to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher. There's a lot of good starters around. God's looking for some finishers, ones who will go the distance, ones who will run the whole race. And so I've been presenting basically the book of Revelation, that it is a revelation of Jesus Christ, a person, and it's a person who is who he is and what he's done. He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, we're going to see. He is the Son of Man and the Son of God. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end, and he wants to get that so clear that that really he is everything. He is all that we need. And so when we looked at chapter 4 and chapter 5, and we saw about the scroll that had the seven seals on it that nobody could open, and John begins to weep. Everybody says, well, what's that scroll? Well, the elder comes over to John and he says, don't weep, because the Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed to open the seven seals. And then he looks and he sees a lamb. And the Lamb is the Lamb of God, the same one that John the Baptist pointed to. Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. And that Lamb is Jesus, right? Jesus Christ. And that scroll is nothing less than the new covenant that was prophesied all the way through the old covenant. God says, I'm going to make a new covenant, not a covenant of works, not a covenant of your own performance, but it's a covenant of grace. It's a covenant where, yeah, Jesus Christ would come and die the death of the cross for our sins, not for his own sins. He says, I want you to see that. And so the Gospels proclaim it. They initiate it. The book of Acts shows what the church, the early believers, did with this. Single message. They didn't have a lot of other messages. You check out what they preached. They preached the cross. Paul said, I'm not going to preach anything else but Jesus Christ and him crucified. I don't want to know anything else about you. Just show me the crucified life. And then the epistles that Paul and John and Peter write, they're all about understanding. And then the last book of the Bible, the Revelation, is the revelation of Jesus Christ, who he is and what he's done. Is it enough what he did in the first coming? Is it?
Yes.
Well, for a lot of people these days, they're so focused on the second coming and their speculation about what they believe that's going to be all about, that there's very little left of Jesus Christ anymore. It's just their ideas about what the second coming is going to look like, what the signs are, when it's going to happen. I think the latest one right now is that the end of the world is going to come on May the 21st. Wow, really? And even the atheists are having a rapture party on May the 22nd. I hate to say this, but I think I got more faith for the atheists in this one than I do for the believers that are off on a tangent. They're off on a distraction, and they bring disrepute to the name of Jesus Christ. How many times has this happened? How many times are we going to go around and around and around? Okay, the scroll is open. The new covenant is open. It's not time to focus on the seven seals, the seven trumpets, and the seven bowls. It's time to again, refocus on the Lamb. I looked and I saw a Lamb, he says. I looked and I saw an angel come. He had an open book, and that's the new covenant. I looked and I saw two witnesses. And what are the two witnesses? Well, they're the golden lampstand. The lampstand is the church, and it's the Word and the Spirit pouring in, and the oil that gives the light. I mean, where is your focus? What are you looking at? What are you looking for? If it's anything less than the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, we are distracted. And I tell you, in this day and age, we have to have our eyes clearly focused on him. Otherwise, he says, your distraction will become foolishness. And a lot of people might recognize it before you do. So God wants to make a difference. Okay, so we ended off last week with the mark of the beast. We ended off there and I left you all hanging. Most people, when they go to the book of the Revelation, that's the first place they go to. And they want to know, what's the mark of the beast? They want to know what the mark of the beast is so they can avoid it. What a way to live. Spend your life trying to avoid something. I'd say that's pretty backwards. That's not just putting the cart before the horse. That's got no horse, no cart. It's just flapping around doing something or other. It's foolishness, because there is so much speculation about this, the mark of the beast. Remember, we saw the seal of the living God in chapter 7. If you got the seal of the living God, you don't have to worry about the mark of the beast. And what was the seal of the living God? Well, we saw that the signs in the Old Testament pointed to it. Ezekiel said it is the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, Taf, which is a cross. And everybody who had the sign of the cross, not just tattooed or whatever on the front. No, it means a renewed mind. He says, whoever has that, you don't have to worry about being killed by the enemy or taken out by circumstances. And in the same way here, in verse 18, the last verse of chapter 13, we got these two beasts coming up. One from the sea and one from the land. The sea is from the Gentile nations. The land, the earth, is from the Judea. And so we had a political system and a religious system. Remember that. That's basically what these two beasts are. Two powers. Okay. One is Roman, one is Jewish. And they actually are coming together here. Now he's saying... the second beast actually causes an image to be made to the first beast and causes miracles and signs and wonders, and people are marveling about this. Now, John says here is wisdom. How many want wisdom? Okay? Wisdom is knowing the right thing to do at the right time. It's not trying this and trying that. Yeah, here is wisdom. If you want to see through this, then let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast. Okay, now he says it's a number. It's foolishness to get distracted in this. And we've been looking at how God wants to get our attention off of the distractions, off of the speculations that are out there, all of the different messages that are going around these days. Oh, God told me. Oh, God showed me. Oh, really? If it doesn't line up with this word, then it's confusion. And we should stay far away from it. We shouldn't even look at it. Don't get fixed on that. It'll just bring more confusion. Okay? But he says here, if you want to know about the mark of the beast, well, like I say, you want to know about chapter 13, read chapter 7 first and make sure you get the seal of the living God, which is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can only come in Jesus' name and witness to the new covenant. It's the sign of the new covenant. The sign of the old covenant was circumcision, keeping the Sabbath. These were the signs of the old covenant. The sign of the new covenant is, do you know the sealing of the Holy Spirit? Do you know a renewing of your mind according to this word? Makes all the difference. Amen? Amen. So he says, but there's a lot of other people they're going to try to go around and figure out, count, or calculate the number of the beast. Because it's the number of man. The number of a man. So what I hear a lot of people doing with this, they're trying to figure out an individual. So, let's see. It must be Henry Kissinger. But a lot of young people now, they've never heard of Henry Kissinger. It's like, yeah, he was 30, 40 years ago, a big candidate for the mark of the beast. Why? Well, he was a powerful man. He was the ambassador, the foreign ambassador of the United States, and he was doing stuff that some people didn't like. He's gone now, though. Well, okay, before him, Napoleon, big man. Hitler, Stalin. Good candidate. I mean, he has to be evil. The most evil, right? So whoever is the most evil, he could qualify for this. If you're Canadian, it was definitely Trudeau. But he's gone now too. Oh, maybe it wasn't Pierre. Maybe it's the Nick guy. Who knows? And there's the political pundits play with this football back and forth. In the 80s, though, there was a man who really externally filled the bill of this one. He had the mark right here. President Gorbachev of the Soviet Union. And there were so many people saying, that's him, we know, that's him, he's got the mark. It was a birthmark, that's what it was. They said, oh no, he's got the mark of the beast. People were teaching this. People were paying money to buy this kind of material. Well, Mr. Gorbachev, 20 years later, we know what happened. He presided over the dissolution of the Soviet Union, probably one of the best things for Western democracy and our way of life, and pretty soon people started to cheer him. It's amazing who is the beast one day can become an angel the next, according to speculations. But you know, if we just go by our speculation, we can end up very foolish and dead wrong. 20 years later, Mr. Gorbachev is now a born-again believer in Jesus Christ. He's baptized just this year.
Wow.
You know, we got two tendencies. We'll idolize and we'll demonize. The same thing with certain presidents of the United States. Depending on your political philosophy, I think which beast you're riding on, because the sea beast is a political animal. And then the land beast, that's a religious animal. When you put those two together, you better watch out how you knit them together, or you could end up with a lot of egg on your face, a lot of foolishness. So, what is? I hope you took some time since the last time we got together here to really look out. What is the mark of the beast? Well, it says it's the number of a man. Now, in Greek, the only problem is there is no article "ah." So it's not an individual man. And don't call him Antichrist, because you cannot find the word Antichrist in the book of Revelation. Okay? There is a spirit of Antichrist. It's against Christ. It can only come once the Christ has come. Because you can't have an anti-something until the real one has come. It's like you can't have a counterfeit bill unless you got the real bill. Amen? Okay, so there are many Antichrists, John said. And it's not individuals as much as a move, a spirit of Antichrist that manifests itself in different ways. Really, in the Greek, what it's saying here, it's not the number of a man as much as it's the number of mankind. It's his number, 666. And it's three times. Man was created on the sixth day. And six, when you put it as three of these, 666, what is it? It's like two-thirds put into decimal form, 0.66666. It's always trying. It'll keep on going, but it never approaches seven. And seven is God's number of fullness and perfection. Man on his own is always falling short. He can never attain to God's fullness of seven. It's the number of incompleteness, imperfection, failure upon failure, consistently falling short. It's the number of man on his own without God. It's the number of labor. 6 days you shall labor. It's the number of bondage. If a Hebrew was in slavery, he could only be held for 6 years. Then on the seventh year, he had to be released. It's the number of rebellion against God. Goliath was measured in 6 cubits. In other words, when David saw him, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, it's the number of man he's coming down. Right away, he could see that Goliath was, he was destined for the floor. He wasn't going to stand there and bellow anymore. Nebuchadnezzar's image was 60 cubits high. That's 90 feet. But God measures it in his word by 60 plus 6 cubits wide. It was all of gold. It's the number of the talents of gold that Solomon amassed in 1 year. 666 talents. But God had told him at the beginning he should never put his trust in gold, horses, or women. And those things would bring him down. And here, yes, he took his eyes off of God. He took his eyes off relationship with Jesus Christ, And he started amassing gold, and it numbered 666, but it never reached 7. You read Ecclesiastes, he was a very unhappy man. So we see these things about the number of man, 6. And when it's 666, it's heightened all the more. So man in himself will always fall short. The enemy will exploit that. But there's a beautiful thing about the number 6. Satan was crushed on the 6th day. On Friday. Well, he thought, when he conspired to have Jesus crucified, he thought, well, this is it. I'm going to come out the winner here. But really, he was planning his own demise there. What does this mean here when you take this all together? Well, in the primary context, you got to look at it in John's era. In this time from 30 to 70 AD, and I believe the book is written about 5 years beforehand, 65 AD. He's writing to comfort the church. He's writing to warn the church. He's saying there is a collusion of a political system and a religious system, and it's conspired. It's conspired to crucify Jesus, and it's conspiring to persecute the church. And you need to have wisdom in this so that you look unto Jesus and you don't look to those things to try to work it all out and stay away from it. Just follow the Lord through this. So basically, he's pointing out these two systems, these two beasts. And he's saying that it's at work now. It's been released somehow to do its work. And it's but ultimately, everything that it does is going to destroy itself. That's how the world system, politics, and religion work together. And so he exposes it. He unmasks it here. He says, here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast. Which beast? The first beast. The sea beast. For it is the number of a man. His number is 666. They did not have numbers like you and I have them. 2,000 years ago, there were no Arabic numerals. There were Roman numerals. So Roman numerals actually have a numeric value, right? I is 1. Then you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 4. V is 5. X is 10. C is 100. Like this. So each of these letters has a numeric value. Now, some people have done the work on it, and you take Nero Caesar. Nero Caesar, in its Hebrew letters, there's 7 of them, and the numeric value adds up to 666. It couldn't come right out. It's like in some countries where you're forbidden to preach the gospel these days. You can't come out and preach against some of these things, but they use codes. They use codes. And that, I believe that's what he's doing here. In his primary context, he's unmasking that Nero is the one who's behind this political movement to persecute the church. He's the first one, right about this time that the book was written, that actually he burned the city of Rome, and then when the people were mad at him, he blamed the Christians because he was looking for a scapegoat. And then he had Peter arrested and killed, and he had Paul arrested and killed. All at this time, it was the first general persecution of the whole church. It was a terrible time. Many, many hundreds, thousands of believers died at that time. So he's warning them. He's getting them ready for it. Okay? But there's also a general context here. And these two systems, he says, don't worry about it. Really, they're sealing their own doom. They're working against themselves. This political, religious agreement together, all the forces of Antichrist are ultimately, no matter what form they appear in, they're going to bring one another down. Can you see that picture? Okay, it's 666. It's sick, sick, sick. And it's not going to prosper. Do you know that when you're in the midst of persecution? Do you know, not persecution for your own lust, persecution for taking a stand for Christ. That's what it is. Not because of your own sin. Okay? God's dealt with that on the cross, and so should we. Right? That's a beautiful sign. Tough. Now, this sign, the mark of the beast, that's an unhealthy sign. And he's saying, that's a sign of going down. So don't be allied with that. Any If something's got the word, three letters, ism behind it, watch out. Mm-hmm. Humanism, globalism, totalitarianism, communism, denominationalism, or what was it, demononationalism. You know, anything that takes the place of that it's only for Christ himself. You got it? Oh, that's the end of the mystery? Oh, I'm so disappointed. I thought at least you'd tell me it was Barack Obama or somebody. Then I could form a political party and we could work against them. Now that's speculation.
That's right.
Brings foolishness. Who knows? Well, like Gorbachev, maybe he's a Christian. Maybe. You know, there's a lot of speculation about people. You see, and when you start looking at that kind of stuff, you are distracted. You have taken your eyes off of Jesus, and that's the trick of the enemy. That's how Antichrist works. And I say, the Bible shows us, don't go there. Amen?
Amen.
In fact, the next verse, chapter 14, then I looked, and behold, a lamb standing on Mount Zion. And with him, 144,000, having their father's name written on their foreheads. I mean, what a contrast. So many people are stuck back on verse 18 of chapter 13. And God says, no, come on, don't look there. Look on chapter 14, verse 1. Get caught up with the Lamb of God. And the 144,000, well, don't worry about that. That's you. That's 12 times 12 times 1,000. Remember chapter 7? We looked at it. Those who were sealed with the Holy Spirit. They got the Father's name on their foreheads. Their minds are renewed. It's the same picture as in chapter 7. But there's a lesson here. What are you apt to look at? What are you looking for? And God wants to train us. But we've been trained by the world. We've been trained by speculation. We've been trained by the sensational. And God says, no, don't put your eyes there. Get your eyes on the Lamb. Because remember last week we were looking at who is going to stand? Well, what's this Lamb doing? He's standing. He's standing. And the 144,000, 12 times 12, the number of government, the church, the fully redeemed are standing with him. And where are they standing? They're standing on Mount Zion. Hallelujah. Hebrews said you haven't come to the Mount Sinai about the law and doing all this performance stuff. You've come to Mount Zion and it speaks better things. This is a covenant of grace. So he says here, these are the redeemed, the complete, perfect, spiritual Israel. They're singing a new song. They've got harpists playing. The four living creatures that are the gospels and the elders that are symbolic of the church. They're singing this song. They were not defiled with women, verse 4. Now, if you're a literalist, you're going to have trouble with that. I've heard all sorts of people speculate about this and say, well, I guess if you're married, you'll never going to, you know, ever had a sexual relationship with anybody. You missed it. What a bunch of baloney. He's not saying that here at all. He's saying it's just a symbol of sexual purity, for they are virgins. And when you come to Christ, God washes all that away by his blood. Amen? Whatever was in the past. That's the beautiful thing of the new covenant. Amen? How many of us need a new covenant? Of course we did. You needed one too. Each and every one of us need that. You know, we need a fresh start. We need a whole new beginning. Naturally, we are 666. But God wants to make you a seven in Christ. These are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. Oh, that's what I want. I want to be so caught up with looking unto Jesus and not distracted by anything. I want to be solely focused on him. And we can know that. We can know his presence leading and guiding us. They were redeemed. In other words, they were bought out of the marketplace of sin. They're first fruits, the most costly. And in their mouth, no deceit. In other words, they're no double talk. Their word is yes and amen. And they're without fault. There is actually no rebuke. Really, the phrase here is the same as in Ephesians 5, verse 27, when he describes the church. A glorious church without spot or wrinkle. It's the same phrase here. In other words, there's no rebuke. The enemy can't come and accuse you. Because there's no condemnation to them who are in Christ. Amen? Amen. So then he goes on. He says, you got that picture? Now we're going to run with it, he says, because three angels are showing up. And over the next six verses, we got bang, bang, bang. One preaches the everlasting gospel. And some people say, well, that's going to go on for a long, long time. Some people say it's another kind of a gospel. No, it's the same gospel. Jesus Christ died, buried, resurrected. We're free from our sins, and he's ascended to the throne, and he's ruling and reigning in the kingdom. That's the simple gospel. Amen? Amen.
Thank you.
You believe that?
Yes.
Well, you can take that one to the bank, and even better than that, okay? It's the same gospel. But here, what is he doing? He's preaching it to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people. Same phrase that we saw in chapter 5 and in chapter 7. But here, nation is first. It's not tribes that are first. In other words, it's to all the nations. And it's not just one nation now. It's not just Israel, natural Israel. But it's Jew and Gentile together. You got that picture?
Right.
Yeah? Okay. So then the second angel comes and he says, Babylon is fallen, is fallen. That great city, it's fallen. Now, we're going to see later on, this is the introduction to the whole message that he's going to be bringing out here. And then he says, the third angel shows up, and he says, if anyone worships the beast in his image and receives his mark, well, we should know already, don't go there. It's a distraction. And this third angel comes up and says, if anybody does that, you know, you're united with that one. It's like sexual relations, impure sexual relations. You're one body, you're one flesh with that person. And the same torment that's going to come on the beast will come on you if you're joined with that. So get out of there. It's basically what he's saying. There's going to be torment ascending forever and ever. But then in verse 12, he stops and he says, here's the patience of the saints. Now, he does this a couple times already. He did it after he introduced the sea beast. And he describes, and some people can get caught up, oh, politics, the political system, oh, it's amazing. And he says, no, here's the patience and the faith. Not the faith and the patience. It's the patience first. In other words, the time, the endurance. Like I say, God's looking for people who will finish, not just start. And he says the same thing here. He says, here's the patience of the saints. Keep the commandments. It's in you to keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. And then I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, write, blessed are the dead. Now, this is the second of seven blessings in this book. It took us 14 chapters to get to the second blessing. But we are blessed because we're reading this book, right? Now, he says, this gospel, this new covenant is so good that when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, you don't have to fear death. In fact, it's to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. And he says, I want you to focus on that. Because the dead who die right now in Christ, they go right into the presence of God. Wow, isn't that good? See, when the enemy would kill some of us, they loved not their lives to the death. He's losing. He's not winning. We can't lose. Amen?
Yeah.
Turn to somebody and say, we can't lose. Because we're not losers. Okay? And then he says, their works, their labors follow them. They have rest. And then from verse 14, the end of chapter 14, there is a harvest going on here. And the first few verses is all about a wheat harvest. And then the next few verses is about a grape harvest. And he says, you're going to make some bread, and we're going to drink some wine. The wine harvest isn't as happy as the wheat harvest. God is separating the wheat from the chaff, and then you throw it up. See, you separate it by a stone running over it, and it separates the wheat from the chaff, and then you use a fork to throw it up to the air, and then the wind comes and blows what away? The chaff, because the chaff is lightest. You don't use the chaff. You know what that fork is called? In Latin, it's called a tribule. Tribulation is what separates you. There's a lot of people trying to run from tribulation these days. That's why they say, God, get us out of here before the tribulation comes. I got news for you. God says there's going to be tribulation in everybody's lives. But if you're looking for the great tribulation, then look here, at least what the Bible's saying. Just before 70 AD, when the city of Jerusalem went through great tribulation, he separated the wheat from the chaff, and the wheat came out. Not one Christian perished. Right? So there is a harvest here going on between two seeds, woman's seed and the serpent seed. It's been going on ever since Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. When God prophesied to the seed of the serpent, he said, you know, there's going to be bitter enmity between you and the seed of that woman over there that you just deceived. Oh, you'll get to crush the seed of woman's heel, but he will crush your head.
That's right.
In other words, you're doomed right from the very beginning. And basically, that's what he's coming in here. He sees this vision. I looked, verse 14, behold, a white cloud. Now, cloud speaks of judgment, but white is purity. And one sat on it like the Son of Man. In other words, Jesus is there. He's got a golden crown, a sharp sickle, and he's bringing a harvest. He is not just bringing a little remnant. Remnant is old covenant. Harvest is new covenant. Can you see the harvest? So many people are so speculated and they're focused on, well, will I make it? Will we make it? Will anybody make it? It's not a matter of will anybody make it. It's can you see the harvest? Jesus planted himself as a seed and he's bringing forth a harvest. Amen? Well, he says that's a harvest. The earth was reaped. Then another angel came. He had a sharp sickle, and he said, put it in, take the grapes, for the grapes are ripe. It's time. And so the angel thrust in the sickle, verse 19, into the earth. Now here, earth means Judea. He's getting very particular. And he threw it into the grape wine press. Oh, we're going to make some good wine here. No, it's the wine press of the wrath of God. This is not a joyful wine. This is a bitter wine. The wine press of the wrath of God. And the wine press was trampled outside the city. Now, you can't do this in the accepted arena. It's like Jesus was crucified outside the city. Hebrews says, let us therefore go outside the city. Going outside, what he's saying here is that Jerusalem is under the curse of judgment. It never received the new covenant. She crucified her Messiah. The people said, let his blood be on us. And now the blood is coming. Now in communion, the water turns into wine, turns into the blood of Christ. What's happening here is it's turning into the blood of judgment that's coming on the city. So he says, go outside the city. Threw it into the great wine press. Blood came out of the wine press up to the horses' bridles for 1,600 furlongs. 1,600. Now, how do you measure 1,600 furlongs? What's a furlong? 8 feet, something like that? It's probably about 180 miles. If this is literal, you've got blood up to the horses' bridles for 80 miles. Somebody's trying to tell me, you know, the Valley of Jezreel or Armageddon's going to be like that. I'm sorry, you can't even get 200 million people in there. This is figurative, this is symbolic. 1,600, 4 times 4, 10 times 10. 4 by 4 are the four natural elements, the four corners of the earth. 10 is a number of God's quantitative fullness. In other words, in one sense, if we're referring to the blood of Christ, there's enough blood for forgiveness of every sin. Why? Because it's up to the horses' bridles. And what do horses symbolize? Natural strength. He can actually wash away all of the natural strength that is needed in a particular life. That's if you're open to the mercy of God. And if you're not, there's enough judgment to deal with your pride. Verse 8, chapter 18, or 17. Then, one of the seven angels. Okay, we're skipping over the bowls. We're skipping over the seals and the trumpets and the bowls. Those were the destructions that were happening. Then we were looking at the interludes. God wants us, don't focus on the judgments. Don't focus on the destructions. Don't focus on the distractions. Focus on the Lamb, right? Okay? But now, here's a very subtle distraction. And then one of the seven angels, chapter 17, who had the seven bowls, came and talked with me, saying to me, "Come, and I will show you the great harlot." No, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot. You know, it's an amazing thing. The harlot, what have we just seen? We've seen the Lamb of God with 144,000, the bride. They're both women, a prostitute and a bride. Vast difference between the two. But a woman is always symbolic of a church in the Bible. And the woman brought forth, she was the woman that was bringing forth the church. A woman is saved in childbearing. I don't believe that's just literal. I believe that's spiritual. The church thrives when it brings forth born again sons and daughters. Okay? Now, he's saying here, there's a competition going on for what you're going to look at. And there's many, like Proverbs says, there's women out there in the street that have a prostitute, a harlot spirit, and they're seeking to seduce and deceive and to bring astray. And Solomon says to the young men, he says, don't go there. Of course, a lot of young men still go there. Duh. That's not wisdom. That's foolishness. Some of us go there too. We try to figure out the harlot. We try to have coffee with the harlot. We try to get as close to the world system without, well, losing our salvation. But that's deceptive. Okay, but he says here, she's judged. And I want to show you the judgment of it, so that you will not be enticed to share in her wares. Because if you share in her wares, you're also going to have to share in her judgments. Okay? So he says, I want to show you. She's sitting on many waters, and he carried me away, in verse 3, into the wilderness. In chapter 12, the woman, the church, was carried away into the wilderness. Now this one is carried away into the wilderness too. They can both be in the wilderness, they can both be women, but they're not the same. One is a harlot and one is a glorious church, the bride of Christ. Now she's sitting on a scarlet beast and has names of blasphemy, 7 heads, 10 horns. Who else had 7 heads and 10 horns? The dragon. And we know where he's from. She's sharing the same things as him. She cannot hide herself. And she's sitting on many waters. The many waters in verse 15 are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. In other words, these are the Gentiles. There's a political Gentile movement that she's associated with. The waters. And she's also sitting on a beast, the sea beast, which we've already found out in chapter 13 is Rome. The Gentile political system. Oh, she's all decked out in all sorts of purple, royal colors, scarlet, luxury. It's the same colors that were in the veil of the Holy of Holies that separated from the holy place. And then Jesus tore that veil in two. Same colors. Yeah, so it's amazing how an Antichrist spirit will put on a good show. The best counterfeit is the one that comes closest to the truth without being it. The best lie is the one that comes closest to the lie without being it. And there's a lot of good counterfeits around these days, spiritual counterfeits. And he's going to expose this harlot. She's got a, on her name, well, she's got a golden cup and it's full of abomination. You know, it's like a parody of somebody having communion, but it looks good on the outside like the Pharisees, but inside it's full of abomination. And on her forehead, she's got a name, a blasphemous name. Mystery, Babylon the Great, mother of harlots and of the abominations. She's actually proud of it. She's strutting her stuff. But God says, I am going, this is like Jezebel in the Old Testament. You know, Ahab's wife, she was a queen. She killed the prophets of the Lord. She persecuted Elijah. It's the same kind of spirit that is now being manifested here in a church, says that it's church, a religious system But it's full of programs. It's full of the blood of the saints. It's not taking care of people. It's using people. Full of fornications, drunk on their own wine. It's indulging in itself. It's reproducing its own image. It's the mother of all harlots. Remember when they declared war against Iraq and Saddam Hussein said, the mother of all wars is starting. You know, here's the term from the Middle East. In other words, you can't outdo this. This is the be-all and the end-all. And Jezebel is saying, wow, I'm everything that there is. Look at me. And John even gets so caught up with it, he says he saw her, verse 6, and he marveled. He got caught. Wow. But the angel said to me, why are you marveling? John, get it together here. You're distracted. You're focusing on the wrong thing. I will tell you the mystery. Okay? People are all excited about the mystery, but it's time to look for the revelation. And the revelation is not of the harlot. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Amen? Do you see it? Okay? There's an exposing going on here at the same time that there's a revealing. There's a revealing of Jesus that exposes everything else. Okay? No matter how close it comes to the truth. Is it 7 heads and 10 horns? That's nothing. That's like that sea beast that we saw back in chapter 13. The 7 heads, there's 7 mountains on which the woman sits. There's 7 kings. 5 have already fallen. 1 is, and the other not yet come. Well, in John's context, it's very simple. That's Rome. 5 Caesars have already lived from Julius all the way through, and the 6th one is Nero. Shows us the exact date of when this actually is. Okay? And then he says, one is going to come, but only for a short time. Well, after Nero committed suicide, there was a lot of trouble in the Roman Empire, and they had 3 emperors within 1 year. Then he said, the 10 horns, verse 12, which you saw, there are 10 kings. There were 10 Roman provinces that shared his power like that. And he says, they'll all be of one mind, and they will fight against the Lamb, but the Lamb will overcome them. For he is Lord of lords, verse 14, and King of kings. You got it? In other words, don't focus there, focus here. Don't get distracted, focus on the Lamb. Those who are with him are called, chosen, and faithful. And then he goes more into the 10 horns, and he says, she's got a cup that is full. And this woman, this Babylon, she's saying mystery, but you can blow her cover really good. The Bible speaks of 4 harlots. There was a harlot of military might, Nineveh. There was a harlot of commerce, Tyre. There was a harlot of pleasure, Babylon. And there was also a harlot of religion called Jerusalem. Isaiah exposes her right in chapter 1. He says, how has that which is meant to be the city of God become a great harlot? And John picks up on that. And now he's saying, she's given herself to a religious system, and this religious system has crucified Jesus Christ in collusion with the political system of Rome. See, the harlot is riding the beast, but the beast supports the harlot. They're together in this. He says, but don't you worry, John. They're both coming down. And while they're coming down, God is raising up a new body called his church. The bride. Can you see her? Can you see her? Because the revelation of Jesus Christ is also the revelation of the church. The Lamb and the 144,000 are right there together on the mountain. Okay? Chapter 8. The woman whom you saw is that great city. Now, that phrase has been used a couple of times here. When the 2 witnesses give their testimony, and there's a measuring of the temple. He says, that great city called Sodom, Egypt, where our Lord was crucified. You look at that in chapter 11. You put this together, scripture interprets scripture. There's no confusion about which city this is. This is Jerusalem. This is old Jerusalem, old covenant Jerusalem. This is religious Jerusalem, the one where our Lord was crucified. You go to chapter 18. After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority. He cried mightily with a loud voice, Babylon the Great is fallen, is fallen. In other words, just what Isaiah prophesied all the way through his book. That's where this prophecy starts, and then it's picked up in Revelation. Now it's come to full conclusion. He says it twice. In other words, there's no doubt about it. It's fallen. It's not going to get up again. That which is Babylon, and that which is Jerusalem in the old. You know, Babylon means originally the gateway of God, but it became Babylon, the tower of confusion. The same way as Jerusalem means here is peace, but now it has become anything but peace. It's fallen. The old covenant system is exposed. He says it's demon infested. It's a dwelling place of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, a cage for every unclean and hated bird. Birds are unclean animals. They're like vultures. They pick the carcasses. He says that's what's going to happen with this city. And you read Josephus, that's exactly what happened. Verse 3, chapter 18, verse 3. For all the nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. And the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. There's three classes here. The nations, the kings, and the merchants. In other words, there is a collusion here of the pleasure of lust. They're involved in abomination, the nations. The kings, they're seeking power through politics. And the merchants, well, we know what they're into. They're into money. Now you follow chapter 18, is all the way through these three classes of people, which takes in every part of the world system. And he's saying, they're not only in agreement, in an alliance together, but they're going to all come down together. Okay? And verse 4, I heard another voice saying, come out of her, my people. In other words, here's the warning again. Like I say, old Jerusalem was under the judgment, but God made a way and all the believers came out. Now this is the last call right here. Don't have any alliance with that system. It's doomed. Render to her just as she rendered. Repair double. Mix double for her. In the measure that she glorified herself and lived luxuriously, give her the same measure of torment and sorrow. For she says in her heart, verse 7, like Jezebel when she painted herself up and sat up in the window, she says, I sit as a queen, I'm no widow, and I won't see sorrow. Everything's okay. And if you're with me, you'll be okay too. But God says, oh no. Your plagues will come in one day. Death, mourning, and famine. You say that you sit as a queen, you will have a plague of famine. These things happened exactly. You see, a city is personified here as a prostitute. These things happened in Jerusalem. Mourning, you say you're no widow, you are going to experience mourning like no other. You say you will see no sorrow, you are presumptuous. And you will see sorrow upon sorrow. You will know mourning as never before. Now that's God's judgment. And it happens. And look at the reactions. Verse 9. The kings of the earth who committed fornication and lived luxuriously with her will weep and lament for her when they see the smoke of her burning, standing at a distance. See how? The beast, the sea beast will distance itself from the land beast when her judgment comes. Saying, alas, alas, that great city Babylon. They even say, alas, alas, twice. That mighty city, for in 1 hour your judgment has come. That's what the king said. Verse 11, and the merchants, the guys with the money, the ones with the power and the ones with the money, say the same thing. And then you go down to verse 17. They all say the same thing. And the shipmasters. Now, shipmaster, that's different in here. Well, ships are symbolic of that which sails on the sea. Sea is the Gentiles, the nations. So we got the kings, the nations, and the merchantmen. And they're pulling their hair out. They're making a really good show of mourning. But really, they're standing at a distance. They don't want anything to do with Jerusalem when she burns.
There's no one came to help them.
Exactly. For in 1 hour. And then it says, just in the midst of this, verse 20, but rejoice over her, O heaven, and you holy apostles and prophets, for God has avenged you on her. In other words, again, don't get distracted with this, but focus. You've got joy. Because this is God as at work in the center of it, not just in John's context back in 70 AD with the destruction of Jerusalem, but in our context, every system, every culture that worships worldly success, power, money, and pleasure strikes the sparks that inevitably consume itself. The American dream is not equal to the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God does not equal all of this stuff that we so easily get distracted by. And it becomes idolatrous in our lives. Now there's a final doom here. Verse 21, a mighty angel takes a stone like a great millstone, and he throws it into the sea. And he says, thus with violence the great city Babylon shall be thrown down and shall not be found any more. Wow. What Jeremiah prophesied, he actually sent a message to Babylon, and he said, here, take this message and put it around, tie it around a rock and throw it into the Euphrates. He actually did that. Now John picks up on that image and he says, Babylon's come down. It's come down. And he says, it shall not be found anymore. No more. This little phrase, no more, actually a double negative 6 times in the next 3 verses. There's not going to be any more music. There's not going to be any more craftsmen. There's not going to be the sound of a millstone, a light of a lamp, or the voice of the bridegroom and the bride anymore. Not going to be there. No more. Oh, what does that mean? It means that music, joy, skilled workers, productivity. That's what a millstone means. Revelation, the light. The anointing, bride and the bridegroom, that's the covenant relationship. You can't have that with Babylon. Don't be a part of that. It's deceptive. It's deceitful. It's a lying spirit. A prostitute says that you can have intimacy by money. It's a lie. You cannot buy God's favor. It's a free covenant. It's a new covenant. It's a covenant of grace. Why not? Verse 23, your merchants, your leaders, were the great men. And by their sorcery, all the nations were deceived. And in her was found the blood of prophets and saints and of all who were slain in the earth. In other words, the society of this, the foundation is rotten and it's going to come down. So don't have any part with that. There is no other foundation that man can have in his life except that which is already laid, which is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That's the only thing that is going to stand. Can you see it? Well, he says, in case you don't see it, in case you're distracted with the prostitute here still, and she's gone up in smoke and all this, he says, chapter 19, focus, focus, focus on the bride, the marriage supper of the Lamb. It's in direct contrast to number 18. Chapter 18. You're either looking at a prostitute or you're looking at a bride. And if you get your eyes on the bride, wow. Come on, guys. How did she look when she came down the aisle? Your eyes were steadfast. Your eyes were fixated. It was a good thing. It's not lust. It's love. Right? Well, the same thing here. He's saying, I heard a loud voice of a great multitude saying, Alleluia! This is where the Alleluia chorus comes from, okay? 4 times here in the New Testament. Only times. Right here. Alleluia. What are they singing about? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Salvation, glory, and honor, and power. Her smoke, the prostitute's smoke, is rising up forever. Praise the Lord, and the 4 living creatures fell down and worshipped, and the elders too. The church and the gospels agreed together, and they say, Amen. We know what Amen means. It means, I agree. I'm with you in this. We confirm this. And then it says, a voice came from the throne saying, praise our God. And then, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, the sound of the many waters, the sound of many thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. You see, you become who you worship.
That's right.
And what's coming off the throne? If you're focused on the throne, that same spirit is going to fill you. If you're focused on the prostitute, lust is going to fill you. You want to get rid of lust? Focus on Jesus Christ, not Antichrist. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife, her bride, has made herself ready. Oh, hallelujah. You know, there's some people still waiting for this. But Jesus taught about the marriage supper that he sent. And he said, you know, I came to my own, and I sent out the invitations, but they wouldn't come. So then I said, well, go and invite all the other ones who, they're just sitting around, they're not doing anything, let them come. And the others, he says, we'll send out my armies and we'll destroy them. This is marriage supper that's going on right now. The bride of Christ is a spiritual bride. Now the prostitute, the harlot, that's spiritual too, but wrong spirit. He says, you are actually being included here, and the wife, the bride, all those who have put their trust in Jesus Christ, they have a part of this. He says, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Do you see yourself there? God wants you to see yourself included here by the grace of Jesus Christ. You're clothed. You've got a wedding garment on. Fine linen, which is the righteous acts of the saints. In other words, the purity of Christ. His white robes. And then John gets so caught up in this, though, he gets distracted. This is such an amazing thing. And the angel's telling him about it. He bows down on his face to the angel and worships the angel. And the angel said, John, what are you doing? Don't worship me. You worship God. He says, the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus. I'm telling you things you've never seen before, but it's all about Jesus. And don't you dare begin to speculate and get into idolatry on this stuff. Oh, yeah, okay. Now, verse 11, I saw heaven opened. And God wants you to see this. And behold, a white horse. Well, the white horse, yeah? But don't worry about the white horse. Don't try to figure out the white horse. He who sat on him. That's the most important thing. Okay? They're marveling about the harlot, and she's sitting on the beast. But here's the white horse, and I want you to look at who's riding him. Okay? He says, wow, he's called faithful and true. He has a name written that no one knew except himself. And then he shows us the name. This is no mystery. It's the word of God. And then in verse 16, he's got it emblazoned on him. King of kings and Lord of lords. Is there any doubt who he is? You know, he's the rider on the white horse. It's Jesus.
That's right.
He's the one that the good news is all about. He said, don't focus on the bad news. Focus on the good news. In righteousness, he rides and he makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire. On his head, many crowns. More crowns than the dragon had. Yeah, what does this sound like? Sounds like the vision that John had in chapter 1 when Jesus showed up in the middle of the candlesticks. Out of his mouth goes a sharp, two-edged sword. Well, that's the word of God, and he's clothed with a robe that's dipped in blood. His own? I don't know. His martyrs? I don't know. Isaiah, scripture interprets scripture. Isaiah 63 says it's this enemy's blood. In other words, he's coming. He's coming here on a horse. When he came into Jerusalem, the last week of his ministry, he came on a donkey. Now he is coming on a horse. He is bringing judgment. He's conquering. This is not the second coming. This is now. This war is now. The armies of heaven are riding with him. They have joined together with him. He's coming to implement the victory of the cross. They follow. His gospel is going forth now. Can you say now?
Now?
It's going into all the nations, throughout all generations. Can you see it? And the church has been too narrow-minded on this. We haven't seen the vision. God wants to give the revelation of Jesus Christ, who he is and who we are with him. And the kingdom of God is filling the earth now. And then he says, oh, I saw an angel standing there. And he says, well, come, there's a second supper going on. There's the marriage supper of the Lamb, but there's also the supper of the great God. There's a big flesh eating supper going on. And all the battles are coming together. All of Antichrist is gathering together. All of the forces, the kings, captains, mighty men. But don't you worry, that's just a corpse. You're a living body. The bride of Christ. So he says, I saw the beast, I saw all the battle going on. You know, he only gives, verse 19, one verse for this battle. And then he gives us the battle results in verse 20. The beast was captured, that's the sea beast, and with him the false prophet, that's the land beast, the prostitute, the harlot. And they're both cast into the lake of fire. That's it. Battle. Battle results. In other words, Jesus 7, devil 0. Is the final score, is the utter defeat and destruction of all Antichrist enemies. Don't doubt about them.
That's good. That's right.
Amen.
Good.
Yeah. Yeah. It says rejoice.